Compiler does it as a batch job. What is a batch job? So you give a whole thing together, say maybe 10 lines together, then you compiled it, object file is coming, then you collect the object file, then you link it through linker program, and then you load it, then your a.out or a.exe from Microsoft, it will be loaded in your main memory. And what is interpreter? Interpreter is line by line. So though the traditionally the name is compiler construction, but it is an interpreter. Most of the 99% things are common. I am following this book, and you have already got this book, and there are other materials also. This is the one of the best book. But you should that the compiler how many levels it can go. So generally every compiler is generally two pass, minimum two pass, not a single pass. So the source program comes here and compiled code comes here only in one pass, it is not possible. Even the program is fully correct. So that is thing. The first thing is lexical analyzer. You know the lexical analyzer, what does it do? Say if there are some white spaces in your program, if you have a comment lines like you see, you have a comment line, /*, whatever the thing, */, in Python you have the number sign, and in C++ \, these things will be taken off. The lexical analyzer, what does it do? It all comments line be taken off. So that is the reason we tell you that you write as many as comment lines, your program will not be bigger. So comment lines doesn't go to your program size. But one exception is there, probably you have seen in Python, whenever you declare a function, after declaring a function with a triple quote, you just quote what is the description of the function you write. That portion goes into the object file that will help you to debug your program. So that is few exception, but it's a Python. Vuidi Van Rossum has designed it that way. So lexical analyzer, what is basically does, taken out of the compiler directives. What are the compiler directives? Whether you are directing the compilers, like include standard io.h, import blah blah blah, include our macro definition, constant declaration, it will be taken out by the lexical analyzer. All the white spaces will be taken out. Remember, here the lexical analyzer works very differently in this, whatever in C and Java and whatever in the Python. See, in Python, white spaces acts as a marker, but in C, Java, C++, it is not there. So, role of lexical analyzer would be different C, C++, Java, and Python, because there the white spaces is a punctuation bound for the clarity of the program. Another thing I must tell you, the lexical analyzer gives lots of, say if you do not give semicolon after the end, or if you have start integer variable with a number, or any variable start with a number, or you have a say exclamation mark, or which are not to be determined, which is not to be in variable naming, you put it. So all these name errors and everything would come, would be detected by lexical analyzer. And one thing, last day I have forgot to tell you that whenever the lexical analyzer passes, then it will be a symbol table will be generated. See, here it will be shown as a single table. It is actually not a single table. It is a collection of tables. Or you can say like a forest of tables. You know the data structure forest, it's a forest, so now multiple number of tables. I will detail you. So here the table and this symbol table is have the all the features of the variable, that what type of variable it, what is the scope of the variable, what are the scope of the variable I've told you, then the whenever I'm mentioning the scope of the variable, you know C, Java, the same variable names can be there with different scope. So definitely you should, definitely it would be clear that symbol table is generally made as per the scope of the program. And whenever a program is running, there are multiple scopes, like within a if statement or within a program or within a function, there are multiple scope. So symbol table also should be multiple. Okay, because it is generally as per scope of the, like you know scope, the symbol table is there. And another thing, the symbol table is there, its lifetime is from the, it will be, though it will be generated at the symbol table, at the lexical analysis phase, but most of the details will be put up in by the syntax analyzer phase. Because whenever the lexical analyzer only gives you only the token, nothing like it. And whether there is any error in naming the variable, then the flag will be there, you will get the error and you will get this lexical error. Okay, and the later always it will hit symbol table entries would help, but actually the what are the type of variable and the scope of the variable, all these details filled by the syntax analyzer. And syntax analyzer, we call it a parser, which is the, I have told you, 30 to 40% main topic of this course. Lexical analyzer is a very preliminary part, semantic analyzer. Semantic analyzer, I have told you, it will check it whether the array variable is integer or not. If it is a array variable, cannot be a floating point number, or you want to put an integer into a floating point number. This kind of check, like understanding check, it is done by a semantic analyzer. But one of the most toughest thing is a syntax analyzer. Remember, this is all this portion is called the analysis phase, and then it will be intermediate code generator. This intermediate code generator, it basically, it is not meant for the target machine. It is generally a virtual code generator. Here no actual go to addresses or all these things will not be there. All are labeled type of address. It is basically one kind of, say, not that kind of virtual machine with Java or Python. But you can think is a symbol, is an intermediate code. It can be at once we run with some modification with JVM or Python virtual machine. So even for a C itself, though there is no virtual machine there, but this is an intermediate code, is a kind of intermediate code which cannot be directly run on a machine. So intermediate code, why intermediate code is generated? Because intermediate code is be the same for all types of target machines. So this intermediate form, if we get through this intermediate code, then I can make it on a Sun Spark version, one is Intel 486 version, one mobile code, our mobile machine, that whatever the chips are, the MediaTek is there, or any other. So intermediate code is kind of a mother code, and we generate intermediate code, and then we try to minimize the code, or you can say the when the code should have better performance, all these things will run it out on this intermediate code, which is independent on for your target machine. Then comes the code optimizer. This next stage, this is next, then it is meant for your target machine. If your target machine, how many registers are there, how many, all these things there, then the actual code will be generated. So code generation means two stage, intermediate code and code generator, and there all kinds of advanced programming works. So compiler is nothing but a compiler writing is a full-fledged job, and it is done by the expert programmers, because whatever you name it, it have it, like dynamic programming or say randomized programming or artificial intelligence techniques, because code optimization and all these things are all there. So how to optimize your code, because our CPU become multiple cores of CPU, not a single CPU is very powerful, multiple cores of CPU, and you have your compiler duty is to make a job distributed over multiple cores and get it result. And now you can code it almost like natural language, like we have already done in Python. You see the code is very simple, unlike your C, because C you have to take care of everything, like whether it's a call by value or call by reference and all these things. You are basically machine friendly code, but whenever you are writing code in Python, then you are almost write your algorithmic steps. Whatever the algorithm states, you forget about the machine. Machine will take care of it. So the whole paradigm shift is done from the language. Right now, the more and more language is coming, like Python, R, even Java. But Java still is a purely object-oriented programming. So that's it. So this is thing. Any question regarding this? No, it's a bit kind of repeat, but only new thing. What I added here. That symbol table is not fully constructed at lexical analysis phase. Symbol table mainly constructed, though it is in all the entries are there in the symbol table, and it is not an actual one single table, symbol table. The symbol table is a multiple symbol table, is as per the scope of the program. Whenever your program runs into scope, various scopes, so that many symbol table will be there. Whenever the program runs into a particular scope, then you will check which symbol table, and it has to be there in the main memory. When the compiler runs, it is in the main memory. So symbol table is basically a dictionary kind of data structure. You know Python, it is a dictionary kind of data structure. The left hand side will be the ID number, what the symbol table generated for you. Any token, like ID number is this token, and what are the entries, like which type of variable, maximum limit, upper limit, and any constant, any initialization, what is the scope, everything is stored in symbol table, and it is filled by syntax analyzer. It will be checked in semantics analyzer, that I have told you, any illogical things. So it is syntactically correct, and that you are putting something extra thing into which is unwanted, like your array variable with some floating point number. This thing will be checked by the syntax analyzer, and then if it gets some error, it takes the error from the symbol table. That your symbol table says that it will be array should be integer, but you are getting it from floating point number. So symbol table, for because array error handling is very, very vital thing in compiler construction. Say it is the error handling means whenever you are compiling a program, say 100 lines of program, there may be 2-3 syntax error, there may maybe 2-3 syntax error, 1 or 2 lexical error, 2-3 syntax error, 1 semantic error. So if say around 10 errors, 2 lexical error, 3 syntax error, and semantic error, and what we want the compiler designer, then when we run on compiler, it is a very costly process, at least earlier. Then we should try to detect, we should not stop it at getting only one error, okay? But you will see that if we have a one error, it can generate more errors, but it try to ignore and try to also say that you are missing semicolon. If you run GCC or CC, they'll see, they will prompt you that you missed a semicolon like this, and also try to program more analysis. So they want to catch as many as errors possible. So it should not stop at only single error and report it to you, so that whenever the next time you correct multiple errors. So that is the error handling. So error handling also, your symbol table plays a major role. Because in every error, at a lexical analysis, the error can be there, syntax analysis, the error can be there, and the semantic analysis, the error can be there, and all the errors are generated looking from the symbol. So this is, I have told you, this is analysis portion, this is synthesis portion. We are still here, and this is the most important portion, this analysis. This is the same thing I have told you. Now, next thing we will go to this. This portion I have already covered, like this is a variable. ID number I have already covered. I think though description required this, but this is very, very vital slide, that we all, our programming should be on context free, not only context free, deterministic context. I have told many times why I will not choose the context sensitive grammar or recursively enumerable grammar for programming. Reason is that then your parsing will be NP complete. If it is a regular, the parsing will be linear. But the problem of regular language is you cannot, it cannot have opening parenthesis and end parenthesis. So parenthesis grammar is not there regular, because for the function call you have to call function again and again. You need a context free language, and more specifically is a deterministic context free language. So there the parsing is ONQ, but with clever technique we can make it as ON. So for the compiler construction view, so all our complexities of the language will be limited to deterministic context free language and unambiguous grammar. Unambiguous grammar, I have told, but you also know the grammar should have one and only parsing tree. From left side, only one parsing tree. From right side, another parsing tree is basically the same. So you cannot have two left side parsing tree or two right side parsing tree. Ultimately, that tree should be the same. So that is called unambiguous grammar. So deterministic context-free grammar, unambiguous grammar is suitable for parsing, and you can do it by ON. But there are also restrictions that there we have. We now come to little about the top-down parsing and bottom-up parsing. We'll come to this later, one at a time. This is, we have already covered. Let's see. This one, Shomojit has asked about the WW grammar. WW is a context sensitive grammar. You should appreciate this is very tough grammar. WWR is a simpler grammar. It is a, you can try a non deterministic push down automata can do this. But all this WW grammar or WWR grammar, we do not use it. We generally do not use it in our programming language. Our programming language should be only for deterministic context-free language and also with unambiguous grammar. And also, not full all deterministic context-free grammar, we cannot take it as a model of programming language. We have to devise a, because you know a language can have many grammar, a grammar can have only one language. So a language can have many grammar, so we have to select that grammar. Which grammar is unambiguous? So then we call the language is unambiguous with respect to that grammar. A language can be ambiguous with a different grammar. So we'll force it. We'll not take that grammar. So we'll take only that grammar which is unambiguous. Again, not all unambiguous grammar can be solved in ON. So there are the tricks. So if we go for the parsing, so what is the basically parsing? You are basically giving a series of tokens, and these tokens, if you look at from the left side and from the start symbol, you try to match and try to get it the, you can, whether you get the full string, and your output not only yes or no, whether you have to get it how you generate the string, that we call the parse tree. And another name of parse tree is abstract syntax tree, ASN. I have already described what is ASN, what is the difference between parse tree and ASN, whatever it is, almost same. And there we'll see that if we go for top-down parsing, and there is a famous technique called LL1 technique. LL, first L means you're looking from left, and you are good for left recursive, and you just look ahead only one, terminal symbol, there are some very limitation. Not all non-deterministic grammar with unambiguous cannot be solved. It is better to go for LR1. What is the LR1 basically? LR1, you don't look at from the left side. We look at from the right side of the string, and we try to guess what should be the first, that should be the first S2. Say from S, there may be many rules. From S is the start symbol. There will be rule number one rule, rule number two, one rule. So we have to guess it from the right hand side and try to reach there. And but it is more powerful grammar. It can handle more general language with ON. So one thing I will mind you, see, this all deterministic context-free language can have can have unambiguous grammar, but not all unambiguous grammar can be parsed in O-N. So there is a very small set, not very, but definitely smaller, maybe 60 to 70% set, it can be handled by LR1, and much less, maybe 30% by LL1. So that is the reason most of the programming language is handled by LR1. So that is it. It's a bottom-up parsing, and you are taking from the right-hand side, and we try to reach S. And another is top-down, where it is from the left side, we try to match the string. But ultimately, you have to give your abstract syntax tree or parse tree, which should be our input to your semantic phase, and which should be no unambiguity should be there. So any question till now, you can ask this. Here, this is almost I'm repeating the last classes because I've taken. Here, this is the ON cube. This context free. So you take the whole context free. Even the we want to make it ON. That is the main challenge. And the context sensitive grammar, say A to the power N, B to the power N, or C to the power N, or WW. So the it is NP complete. What is NP complete? I have told you. So what NP complete problem is? If you want to solve the problem, it is exponentially difficult problem to solve it, but somehow you can manage the answer. It can be polynomially checked. So that is NP complete. Okay. So NP complete problem is very tough. Board is this is a type 0 grammar, is undecidable grammar. So that is one kind of dichotomy is there. So you have a Turing machine to solve this, but again you don't have algorithm. So yes, that is a that thing is a very challenging topic of the. Your last stage in automata, we'll try to do it. In compiler, we don't have to go there. In compiler, we mainly focused in our energy in the parsing stage. Here, yes, that is, I think you all know, this is Chomsky's normal form. It is coming from your earlier class. I am not, it is not much helpful right now, but you are aware of. I'm just in which case, yeah, that is one good example. See here, it is, you know, there are two normal forms. One is context-free grammar. One is Chomsky's normal form. One is Graybeck normal form. Most famous is Chomsky's normal form, but Graybeck normal form is a Sheila Graybeck, one of the after Lada Lovelace, or very few lady computer scientists are there. One of them is Sheila Graybeck. She has lots of contribution. So the normal form is left hand side, like any context free grammar should have only one and only variable or non terminal, and right hand side should start only a one terminal and all to the variable. Okay. And what is the S grammar? S grammar says same. It should start with a it should be terminal, but that should be unique. There will be no two rules. Can start with the same terminal. That will very helpful for top-down parsing. That is very helpful. Yes. So this is the Graybeck normal form, and this is not Graybeck normal form because you know it should be non-terminal. It should be non-terminal. So that is not Graybeck normal. Why I am telling the Graybeck normal form and S grammar here? Because S grammar is very easy to parse O-N. Some noise is coming. Is there? Can you tell me? Please, everyone, make your muted. Okay, because I already make my mobile phone. There is a noise is adding because my video camera is not working. Thank you. So why I'm telling about the S grammar? S grammar is very simple, and always parsing can be done by O-N. There is no back and forth. So I have told probably last class. Then in top-down parsing, there is if one is predictive parsing without backtracking. Another is predictive parsing with backtracking. What is predictive parsing with backtracking? So that you try with particular rule from the left-hand side, and it is not come to the final target code. Then you again backtrack. This backtrack is very, very dangerous in computer programming. So we will always energy will it will not only delay your performance, but also it can go infinite loop. So that is the reason backtrack is not everywhere allowed. So this kind of rule, like it is called left recursive, or we have a same terminal in the two rules. It is absolutely okay for Grayback grammar, but not okay for Ace grammar. It's absolutely okay for Grayback grammar. So you have start with the same terminal two rule. So if a top down person, we have to try with this rule first. If it is not okay, then we have to go back and then fire this rule. So this is called back and forth or brute force technique. You know, the back and forth or brute force technique is not welcome in computer science, because computer is basically stupid. It is not intelligent at all. We human, we are always back and forth. We try one thing, and if it is not, we can backtrack. But the computer doesn't have mind till now. So what does it do? If computer goes and come back, it come back to different point, and there might be recursive. So our context free grammar should have such a rule, so there is no same terminal should not be there. So that can be done. We can remove, this is called left recursion. I will tell you, it is a we can remove this, and that is the negative point of the top down parts. We should have one and only terminal, then we can determine which rule to fire. There is very good technique that is called first and follow. This first, you can always take first of a variable, like say, what is the first of capital A? FIRST, first of capital A. First of capital A always A. It can start with only A. Then what is the, say here, what is the first of A? Here the first of a set which can be A comma B, because first of it can start with capital A. Sorry, it can start small A, or it can start with B. And another is follow up A. So follow up A, what is there? The follow up A is the end, is the end of marker dollar. With any string, we in the compiler construction, we always think the string ends with dollar, and dollar will not use it any other purpose. So because after A, nothing is there, we can say follow up A is the dollar sign. Okay. And what is follow up B? Small B, follow up small B is nothing but first of A. What is first of A? First of A is A and B. So what is follow up small B? It is the set consists of small A and small b. What is first of A, small a small b? What is follow up A? It is the dollar sign, and also first of A, because this A have A, so not only dollar, it will be dollar A comma B. Next day I should have whiteboard, I'll definitely make it clear. I just try to give you idea. These are very, very useful function, first and follow. By taking the first and follow function, we can design a LL1 grammar so that no two rule, the first of that particular variable should have any, should shy. That means their intersection should be shy. No common terminal should be there. It looks tough, but it is very easy. It is first and follow function. You just take, if you have a rules, you take the all the non-terminals, you calculate first, FIRST first, and the follow. You try. This is very interesting. This is called top-down parsing. Very easy to understanding top-down parsing. This is called backtracking. The backtracking is nothing but you have a multiple right side rule with the same terminal. You do not modify the rule. So you try with both the rules terminal, both the rules of some capital A start symbol start with small a BC, and another rule small a CC, or then you have with a single a small a terminal, we have two rules. So backtracking means you try with one rule, and if it is not matured, because computer cannot see code them, we human can see a lot of things ahead. But computer doesn't see only one. When we limit it, it can see only one terminal or one character at a time. So it will stupidly follow the rules and then see it is not, then it again it come back. So this is very dangerous. This backtracking will definitely not allow it here. So then we'll go for, so this thing will be totally omitted, but we have shown you, then we'll go for predictive parsing. Predictive parsing here, all the backtracking is removed and then it can be done. If we have a single terminal to begin with, that we can very easily design. We can make first, calculate a first of all strings and all terminals and all variables. And if we see the first of all variables starts with different terminals, then can we go for predictive parsing. The predictive parsing is basically LL1 parsing, no backtracking, and it will give you ON. But what is the negative thing of this predictive parsing? The thing is, looks very, after modification of removing the left recursion, I'll explain what is left recursion. Left recursion means, say a variable starts with A, right hand side again starts with capital A, BC. That is the left recursion. Say your left hand side single variable A, V non-terminal or variable A, right hand side also it starts with a non-terminal. And so that is a left recursion. Whenever there is a left recursion, then it is a very tough for top-down parsing. So we can remove the left recursion by easiest technique, but after removing the rules not look like that so impressive. But the one great thing, if we go for bottom-up parsing, we can see those rules without changing left recursion can be easily done by bottom-up parsing. So that is the reason bottom-up parsing is more powerful. You do not need to change the left recursion, but also in bottom-up parsing you should not do backtracking. Backtracking is absolutely no-no for all this. I try to give the basic principles of parsing. So backtracking, like, is a basic ad hoc arrangement or brute force arrangement, is absolutely no-no, because your performance not only degrade, but also the problem will be infinite loop might be there. So we should change our context-free grammar. So there should not be any left recursion. Left recursion means it should not start with the same terminal, or should not go left hand side and right hand side should the same variable. We can change it, then it we can do it top down parsing.
It removes the comment lines on the compiler.
Yeah, lexical analysis, I have told you. Comment lines will be always done by lexical analysis. Syntax checking, whatever the line token generated is done by a regular. Is a legal grammar or not? That will be checking my syntax. So lexical analysis is run by deterministic finite automata, is by regular expression checker. So there may be regular expression checker, variable, integer. You know what is the regular expression checker of checking variable names, integer, floating point. Thank you very much. Have a nice
day. Thank you, sir.